Senhoras e senhores, boa tarde. Agradecemos a presença de todas e de todos a este evento. O ciclo de conferências UFMG 90, Desafios Contemporâneos, integra a programação especial de aniversário da UFMG, que celebra seus 90 anos em 2017 e conta com a participação de intelectuais, cientistas e escritores de renome nacional e internacional. Convidamos para compor a mesa o reitor da Universidade Federal de Minas Gerais, professor Jaime Arturo Ramírez.
Todas e a todos. Boa tarde, gente. Melhorou. Vamos dar início, então, a mais uma das palestras que compõem o ciclo de conferências UFMG 90 anos, Desafios Contemporâneos. São várias palestras como essas que foram concebidas para ocorrerem ao longo deste ano pela razão que já foi exposta, a comemoração dos 90 anos da instituição. E neste, no que diz respeito a esse ciclo de conferências, nós ouvimos as diversas áreas da instituição colhendo sugestões que pudessem compor conferências como essas, que de fato nos trouxessem um olhar, normalmente de um convidado externo, do Brasil ou do exterior, que pudesse nos colocar perspectivas diferentes em determinadas áreas do conhecimento que, a nosso julgar, no nosso entendimento, são importantes para nos levar a uma reflexão sobre determinados assuntos. E, neste caso específico, eu já quero agradecer aos grupos do Instituto de Ciências Biológicas, em particular ao professor Fabrício Santos, que nos colocou em contato com o nosso convidado, que, se eu pronunciar errado, você me desculpe, é o professor Eske Willerslev, que vai discorrer sobre a palestra Early Peopling of Americas and Extinction of the Late Quaternary Megafauna. Antes de convidar o professor Fabrício, que vai compor a mesa comigo, vai fazer a apresentação do nosso palestrante, eu vou permitir e vou solicitar, vou pedir a autorização de vocês para dirigir algumas palavras ao nosso palestrante em inglês. Ele vai fazer a palestra em inglês. Quem precisar de tradução, ela é possível por meio do equipamento que está disponibilizado. E depois será aberto para uma parte de perguntas da plateia, tá? Então, sou Fabrício, por favor, venha compor a mesa comigo. Professor Willerslev, on behalf of the university, we thank you for accepting our invitation and making the long trip to our country. I hope, I'm sure your stay will be a nice one, and we are very delighted that you have accepted this invitation, and we are sure that your presentation will throw some light and some inspiration in the subject that we have chosen to discuss in this afternoon. Thank you again on behalf of the institution. I'll pass now to Professor Fabrício Santos, that will make your presentation.
Boa tarde. It's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Willerslev. I make the presentation in Portuguese, but I can be pretty sure that we talk very good things about you. Bem, o professor X Willerslev aceitou nosso convite, foi uma grande alegria para nós, né? Eu estou convidando o professor Eske já há 5 anos para vir ao Brasil, em diferentes oportunidades, fui presidente da Sociedade Brasileira de Genética, mas a agenda dele é extremamente lotada, Foi, assim, uma grande honra, realmente, ele aceitar. E ele sempre quis vir para cá, porque muito do tema de pesquisa dele está relacionado a essa região do mundo, a América do Sul, especialmente que é a região do Lagoa Santa. Ele é biólogo e doutor em genética, e atualmente ele é diretor do Centro de Excelência em Geogenética no Museu de História Natural de Copenhague, na Dinamarca, onde está toda a coleção do Peter Lund. É uma coleção que nós visitamos em nome da UFMG em 2013. Eu e o professor Fernando Perini conhecemos a coleção toda, estabelecemos convênios, né? Infelizmente, depois disso veio uma crise, a gente tinha uma série de aspirações de projetos conjuntos, mas a gente continua com eles em pé.
Chega lá.
Sim, sim, nós estamos conversando bastante sobre We are talking about joint projects, collaborations on the Lagoa Santa area and other Brazilian regions. So, e ele tem uma grande expertise na área de sequenciamento de DNA e DNA antigo, que vai ser o tema da palestra dele. Ele estabeleceu o primeiro laboratório de DNA antigo na Dinamarca em 2004, isso é uma ciência recente dentro da biologia. É um pesquisador internacionalmente muito reconhecido nos campos de DNA antigo, biologia evolutiva, genética evolutiva, biologia evolutiva não só humana, animal e plantas também, né, com mais de 250 artigos científicos periódicos de alto impacto, dentre esses, mais de 40 em Nature e Science, né, então realmente uma pesquisa de grande relevância em termos de impacto mundial, né, os interesses dele vão muito além disso, além de paleoantropologia, paleoecologia, paleontologia, arqueologia, domesticação de animais, climatologia, microbiologia antiga, degradação e reparo de DNA e uma série de outras áreas derivadas desse conhecimento que realmente está na vanguarda da ciência, né? Eu diria que é o laboratório de referência do mundo inteiro nessa área de pesquisa. E ele é frequentemente, por isso mesmo, né, frequentemente convidado como conferencista principal em uma série de eventos no mundo inteiro. Então, vocês podem imaginar a dificuldade que é arrumar uma agenda, né, para... Thank you very much for keeping space in your agenda to come here. E estar aqui conosco realmente é uma grande honra. Obrigado. Thank you.
First of all, thank you very much for the invitation. It's a great honor being here, and also a great pleasure because we are undertaking work here in Brazil, and it's my first time here. So previously it was always my postdocs and students who went here, but now I'm finally here, and I enjoy it a lot. It's a beautiful country, and tomorrow we'll go out and visit Lagoa Santa, and I look very much forward to that because that's where I plan to conduct work. So my presentation will be about some of the work we have done on early peopling of the Americas and extinction of the Ice Age megafauna. I will also squeeze in a little bit on the peopling of Europe because it kind of shows where the field is going and what can be done here in the Americas. And that's why I also plan to bring some of that in. It's really, you could say, during my scientific career, I have made, I would say, two discoveries, more than many other people. Two discoveries from where I really have based my research over the entire career. I mean, and
it's just the wrong forearm.
So the first one of them is that we did in 2010 the first ancient human genome. So we basically sequenced, you could say, the entire genome from an extinct human being. It was a hair sample from Greenland, 4,000 years old, and where the DNA was heavily fragmented. And it was an important achievement in the sense that until that point, the general notion in the field of ancient DNA, ancient genetics, was it's impossible to obtain authentic ancient human DNA. And it was really also the focus was on mitochondrial DNA, which is only a small molecule, small genome in each of our cells, right? It's 15,000 base pairs long. To comparison, the full nuclear genome is 3 billion base pairs long. So it really opened a complete new possibility to study human migrations and human evolution. The other one is actually something I discovered during my PhD days, namely that it's possible to retrieve directly from ancient sediments the DNA of a diverse variety of animals and plants. So it's really possible just from a cubic of soil to reconstruct, you'd say, what kind of flora and fauna has been present in an area through time. And this was important because until that stage, the only ways we could really study, you can say, environmental changes was through pollen analysis, where you could isolate pollen grains, calculate them, and through macrophosites. But with pollen, there's a lot of problems of identifying them taxonomically. There's issues with long distance dispersal and macrophosites. You know, many macrophosites are not identifiable, etc. And suddenly, we could actually go take a core sample. Okay, take a soil core, and that's better. Okay, take a soil core, and then retrieve the DNA directly from the sediments, and then reconstruct how has the animal and plant life changed through time. And these techniques we have been applying to various places in the world, trying to understand basically how did modern humans, our species, how did we get the distribution and genetic diversity that we have today. And among those places where we have been working is the Americas. And as many of you probably know, over the years there has been many different theories out there of how the Americas was initially populated. I mean, the general notion is that the Americas are the last continents to be populated by humans. And of course, it means that if we cannot understand what was going on in the Americas, I think there's very little hope we can understand what's going on in the rest of the world, okay? So therefore, the Americas is a very good experiment to kind of try to figure out how powerful are our methods to unreveal what was going on. Anyways, there are many different theories about how this happened. Everything from kind of the classical view that the first people entering the Americas around 13,000 years ago came from Siberia. There was a land bridge connecting Siberia and Alaska. They went in there, and then they were stuck in Alaska for quite some time because there was two major ice caps blocking the way further south. So they were hanging around here until around 13,000 years ago, when these two ice caps melted back, creating a 1,500 kilometer long ice-free corridor. And people, according to this model, was then traveling through this corridor, going into the lower 48 states and quickly moving through there into South America. And on the way, they were killing off all the big-bodied mammals that we know as megafauna, woolly mammoths, mastodons, ground sloth, etc. Other people believe, well, there was people present in the Americas before that time. So this model here assumes that the first peoples that was present in the Americas was the so-called Clovis people, or people having a Clovis technology, which are these huge spear points, you know, that you find that they assume they used to kill off all the megafauna on the way. But there's other people who have said, no, there was people in the Americas before 13,000, and they might have bypassed these ice caps by actually moving along the coast. So this model suggests that there was actually a pre-Clovis occupation in the Americas. Then there's even researchers who have proposed, well, the people, the first people in the Americas didn't come from Siberia at all. In fact, there's researchers claiming that Clovis, the ancestors of Clovis, came from Europe, traveling across the Atlantic because the sea ice was going much further down south during that time. And as other Inuits, they were kind of, or Eskimos, they were hunting sea mammals along the way, getting in here, establishing the Clovis technology, and then later on Native American ancestors came in and killing off, you can say, these Europeans that were here. And you can imagine that theory has caused quite a lot of tension between Native Americans and researchers in the United States. And there's even people who have claimed that there's some kind of connection between the first people in the Americas and Aborigine Australians and Papuans. So as you can see, there's many different versions. Then when we go to the Arctic, that is today occupied by Inuit people, there's also discussions of how many waves of people got into the Arctic. We know that the Arctic was populated at least 5,000 years ago, and but whether these guys are actually the ancestors of present-day Inuits or they are some other kind of people, even Native Americans have been suggested that the first people up here are Native Americans moving north, even going all the way into Greenland. So there's all kinds of ideas hanging around here. So a lot to address. So if we start with the Arctic, let's start with the Arctic. So as I said, there's archaeological evidence for humans' presence 5,000 years ago in the Arctic, but we don't know who these people were. Until we actually went and sampled some of these early skeleton remains in Greenland and in Canada and in Alaska, we sequenced the genomes. We also sequenced the genomes of present-day Inuits, Athabascan Native Americans, and Siberians. And what became very clear is that there has been at least two independent migrations into the New World Arctic. So the first migration, the Paleo-Eskimos, are actually a very distinct group from the Inuits and also distinct from Native Americans. And they are a very strange people in the sense that they occupy this area from around 5,000 years to just 700 years ago, very recently. But they only have one single mitochondria haplogroup. So it's almost like, you know, there was one woman or two women and a bunch of men entering, you know, from Siberia at that time. And then they gave rise to all the people here. And in the beginning, we couldn't understand why are those guys so inbred, right? So we thought it was some kind of strange sexual culture. But in fact, it's probably just because when they met somebody thousands of years later, it was a close relative, right? And what is strange about them is that we don't find any Native American DNA in these guys. So even though we know that they met Native Americans to the south, they seem to have been restricting themselves to each other, right? I mean, so and that's why, of course, they become extremely inbred. Those guys are disappearing around 700 years ago, and this is happening as the Inuit ancestors are entering the New World. They're entering Alaska about 2,000 years ago. They're building up a very sophisticated whale hunting technology, and then they're spreading very quickly across the rest of the Arctic. And as these people are spreading, the Paleo-Eskimos vanish and are going extinct. We don't know why. Was it disease? Were they killed off? What happened? But vanished completely. And in fact, there has been ethnographical records in Canada and Greenland where they say, oh, these people very recently lived very differently, you know, in the 1800s, and maybe they were remnants of Paleo-Eskimos, but when you genetically test them, they are all Inuits. So the last Paleo-Eskimos are now vanished 700 years ago, and they don't seem, according to our analysis, they don't seem to have left any genetics with contemporary peoples in the Americas. What about to the south? What about Clovis? As I said, Clovis with the big spear points, all the different models on how the Americas was populated has a prediction of who should Clovis be. Is Clovis a European? Is Clovis a Native American? Is Clovis some kind of extinct Asian? Is Clovis some kind of Aboriginal Australian life? Or who are Clovis? Clovis technology you find across North America, also down in Mexico. So it's very abundant, Noah. Long geographical regions, a large geographical region. There's only been found one single skeleton associated with Clovis tools. It was found in Montana, and it's a very strange place, Montana. I don't know if you've been there, because it doesn't matter whether it's a piece of gold or skeleton, if you find it on private land, you own it. So this skeleton was found by a farmer back in, I think, in the 60s, 1960s, and he kept it in his basement in a bank box for more than 30 years. And researchers came and asked, can we please study it? No, 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 no. And people wanted to genetics, no, no. And then I heard about this skeleton, and then I sent the paper with our first ancient human genome to this farmer, and his daughter is a molecular biologist. She's not an ancient DNA researcher, but a molecular biologist. And she said, I think this team is the right one to do it, Father. Please give them access. She said, I have only one demand, and that is I want to participate in the DNA extraction from this skeleton. And I said, yeah, come to Denmark. And she said, well, you know, I have a small son. What should I do with him? Bring the son. She said, well, what should I do while I'm doing the work? Who should take care of the son? Bring the nanny, as long as you bring a bloody bone. She came to Copenhagen with that bone, and we sequenced this genome of this 12,600-year-old skeleton. And it turned out to be, genetically speaking, 100% Native American. So it was a major blow, of course, to these other models, the solution theory of people, of Europeans being in there and all that. These theories came, they didn't come out of nothing. I mean, it was because there's presumably similarities in tools, you know, the Clovis tools and tools you find in Europe at the same time. And some people also believe that the skeleton, the cranias, look kind of European and stuff like that. But there we just have to say, it was not a European. It was a Native American, 100% Native American, but what was exciting about it is that this individual, 12,600 years old, the population, the group of people this individual belongs to, seems to be directly ancestral to all Native Americans from where we have comparable data from South America. They are also very closely related to North Americans, but they are not directly ancestral. And this, of course, implies that the last common ancestor between some of the people in the North and some of the Native Americans in the South are older than Clovis, and I'll get back to that in a moment. A lot of my work, as you, it's probably the same here, in the States, doing genetic research on ancient human remains is very, very sensitive. And this was the first ancient human genome ever done on the remains from the Americas. And I spent a lot of my time, and I enjoy it, I would say, I enjoy it a lot, going out to, you know, to the indigenous group. So here in this case, I visited almost all the tribes in Montana. And they were actually quite, they thought it was quite a cool project. I mean, there was no big resistance, although I had been warned by my American colleagues, the archaeologists said I would risk my life going out there, but they offered me tea and coffee and we had nice chats and they were super friendly. There was nothing to be afraid of. But what they all, basically almost all of them said, we want that skeleton reburied because otherwise the spirit will be restless. And of course, it's not my skeleton. It's the skeleton of the farmer. So I had to go back to the farmer and say, well, what can we please rebury this? And first, the daughter said, there's no way this is going to happen. But then this Craw, Native American from the Craw tribe, Shane Doyle, that I went with out to the reservation, she said to her, listen, this child, it's a child skeleton. You have a small boy yourself. What would you say if somebody dig him up 1,000 years later and put his cranium on a shell? And then she cried and said, rebury, rebury. And there was a huge gathering a couple of years ago in Montana where tribes were coming from many different places in the States to participate in these reburying. And it was actually quite an emotional ceremony. I myself had to wear a bulletproof vest. It was not because of the Native Americans, it was actually because of some kind of crazy archaeologist who had threatened it. But otherwise it was a really nice experience. We also worked with another very famous skeletons from the US. It's probably the most famous skeleton in the US. Called, some of you might have heard about it, it's called the Kennewick Man. And this skeleton is not as old as the Clovis boy, it's around 9,000, but it's very famous because when it was discovered at the Columbian River, the first anthropologist looking at the skull said, this looked like a Caucasian, that means a European, right? And everybody thought, well, it's a guy, who, a farmer who fell into the river and drowned, and no big deal. But then they sent that sample out for C14 dating, and it came back 9,000 years. And obviously, suddenly, the whole idea about Europeans being the first people in the Americas came surfacing again. And the five tribes in this area, they claimed this Kennebec man, as it is called, as their ancestor, and said, no, this is not a European, it's our ancestor, and we want to rebury him. And the US government actually wanted to give the skeleton to the tribes. But then a group of archaeologists and anthropologists, physical anthropologists, sued the US government and the tribes. And there was a 10-year-long court case. And the, in the end, the judge said, well, it cannot be given back to the tribes because this is not a, a Native American, based on the cranial morphology. And the Native American tribes were crying and screaming and all kinds of things. And the scientists were laughing and let's study it. And they tried to also to do DNA testing, but failed. They couldn't get anything out of it. Then we got the leftover of the hand bone, a small, small piece that had been used by the US scientists to try to uncover DNA. And from there we could sequence the genome. And we did that. What is interesting, before I tell you the result, is that the same year as we came with our publication, just shortly before, a big book on Kennebec man came out from these studies by the scientists, claiming Kennebec man is not Native American, is actually related to Japanese Ainu people, the original people of Japan, or Polynesians. And he was portrayed on this book with this huge beard and all this. Then our DNA result came out. The guy is 100% Native American, just like Holmes. And in fact, he's very, there was one tribe of the five tribes that decided to provide DNA for comparison. And what we can say, of course, is that he's very closely related to these people. So just before Obama left office, he signed off that the Kennebec man went, got back to the tribes, and he has recently been reburied. And this was a huge thing in the States. I mean, when we released this this work, it was quite interesting because normally the journalists are very interested to hear what the scientists have to say. In this case, they didn't care about us whatsoever. They were interested in to hear what the Native Americans had to say, and they said, we want him back, and it's now, you know, so. It seems anyways, from the genetic data so far, that the first people we find evidence of in the Americas is, in fact, the ancestors of present-day Native Americans. Has there been other people? What about, there's been other claims, also here from South America. Some people have claimed that they exist, the so-called Paleo-Indians, which is, should be a group of people who somehow is more related to, you can say, Australians and Papuans than they are to Native Americans. And some of the remnant populations of these Paleo-Indians should be the Pericus from Baja California or the Fuegans. We did actually get samples of those and we genetically tested those, 100% Native American. Nothing about the other thing. The only kind of, you can say, issue remaining in that regard, at least at this stage to be resolved, is that the Surui here from Brazil, for some reason turns out those genomes that are available turns out to have slightly more kind of Papuan affiliation than other Native Americans. Whether it's an artifact, whether there's something wrong, we don't know. Nobody can explain it at the moment. But this is, and it doesn't mean necessarily that there's been somebody in before Native Americans, I should say, straight away. But that's the only thing that kind of, everything else points to Native Americans being the ancestors of Native Americans being the first people of the Americas. As you probably know, there's been a lot of tension, especially in the States, between various Native American communities and scientists for many years. And it's very unfortunate, and I would say the Kennebec man case certainly didn't help on that. It became even worse. But because of the genetic testing of Kennebec man and of the Ansik boy, there's actually, I would say, a lot of these communities are relaxing off, you know. It's become, suddenly, it's really improved our collaboration with these communities. Now we are working with a community down in Nevada on Spirit Cayman, another skeleton that people have been fighting over, you know, for more than 30 years, and they invited me to come do the work with them, with the Native Americans. This is a Lakota Native American, the Sioux, who believes she is the he's the closest living descendants of the famous chief Sitting Bull. And this we have been testing. I don't have time to go through the whole story. It's quite an exciting story, but I can say here in the talk, we haven't published this yet, but he is actually. So it fits, but I tell you, it was quite an experience what you had to go through to get to the sample of this is Sitting Bull's hair that was cut off by a doctor after he was killed at Standing Rock Reservation in 1891. And I had to go through a ceremony down there with these guys where they got Sitting Bull spirit coming up and telling, this is my hair, and the Dane can get that much of the hair, the rest has to be burned. And this much wasn't enough to generate the genome. So we actually used the next 3 years to generate a new method for looking at relationships. So Sitting Bull really put me on the test there. But yeah, anyways, so where do Native Americans then come from? Where do they come from? I mean, it is kind of puzzling, to be honest, because, I mean, if you look at Native Americans, of course, the closest contemporary relatives are peoples in Siberia, but they're not very close, and you don't really find among contemporary people any really close relatives to Native Americans. So it's been kind of a mystery, but we got some hints, and we got that completely by chance. So I sequenced, my group sequenced the genome of the Maltar boy that you see here from close to Lake Baikal in Siberia. This is the border between Siberia and Mongolia. And it's dated 24,000 years old. And when what was the first surprise, I mean, this area here is an area occupied by Mongolian groups, right? That's what you would call indigenous peoples to a region. And the first surprise was that this individual is not closely related to East Asians or Mongolians, but in fact closely related to people up in Scandinavia like myself. So at first I thought we had a contamination, you know, this might be a contamination. But we sequenced more, and you can quantify the level of contamination was very low. And then it also appeared that they're even closer, is even closer to Native Americans. So it means you had this weird kind of hybrid, right? Between, you can say, something European and something Native American, but not really a lot of East Asian. And I learned always in school that Native Americans is a group of East Asian people crossing the Bering Strait, becoming Native Americans, right? So, in fact, about one third of all living Native American, about one third of the genome comes from this population, or a population very closely related to it. So, probably what happens is that Native Americans were formed by the meetings of at least two distinct peoples. One of East Asian ancestry and one of, you can say, what we call West Eurasian or European ancestry that met somewhere, we don't know exactly where, but somewhere here in Siberia. And the child, if you want, of this population, of this meeting, were the Native American ancestors. It might be more complex than this when we get further results, but this is what it looks like at the moment. So when did people then get into the Americas, and what routes did they take? And this is the, you can see here we have inferred based on modern DNA, modern genomes, that the separation time between Siberians and Native Americans are 23,000 years. But that doesn't tell us, of course, when did they enter the Americas, right? They could have separated from Siberians 23,000 years and then went up here in Siberia and hanged out here for 10,000 years before crossing, right? So this is the problem with modern genetics. Modern genetics don't tell you where things happened. There you need ancient DNA. And also, what route did they take? Did they go through the interior ice-free corridor, as has been claimed, or did they take the coastal route? What happened there? Well, we start getting some clues about this, actually, from Oregon. There's no skeletons dating much further back, really, that we know of with secure dates than the Clovis skeleton 12,600, where it has been directly dated. But we have found feces samples in Oregon. So there's this cave called the Paisley Caves in Oregon, and there's an archaeologist working there. His name is Dennis Jenkins, and literally he finds hundreds of dried out feces. And he called me and said, listen, Eske, I find all these feces, could you please find out whether it's from humans or not? And to be honest, first I didn't think it was very interesting whether somebody took a crap in a cave in Oregon or not. But I went there and we took samples, and they were actually lying in my freezer for about 1.5 years. And then I had this visiting student from Spain coming, and she said, Professor Villas, what should I do? I don't have a project. And I said, look at the shit in the freezer. And she did. And she came back and then she said, well, listen, I find, you know, this mitochondrial DNA that match you know, Native Americans, and I was like, yeah, okay, some of it is human. But then when we looked at the position of some of these samples in the stratigraphy, they were very old. They were at least 1,000 years older than Clovis, right? So it means evidence of pre-Clovis occupation. And that means that Professor Villerslev suddenly got very interested. And we published these results back, actually the first results we published back in 2008. And I have never been criticized so much for some work we have done as in this study. Because in the States, at least, you know, this Clovis first idea, it was, now I'm on camera, it was, I would call it almost religious. I mean, it was like there was people who believed so heavily in the Clovis first idea that there was no people before Clovis, that they simply couldn't accept this. And they said, what a shit job you guys have done. Well, there was some truth to that. But I actually think we have done a reasonable job here. But one of the main criticisms that I never understood, but I'm also not an archaeologist, was you don't find any tools there. And I was like, I don't bring my knife and fork with me to the toilet. I don't know about you guys, but I mean, but anyways, we got money from NSF to dig further, and poor Dennis Jenkins was digging and digging, and we got more feces samples just to confirm the first results. But finally, he found two pieces of broken tools in the Clovis layer, not in the pre-Clovis layer, but in the Clovis layer. But what was interesting was it was not Clovis tools. And it was actually something called Western stem point. And this, according to the Clovis first idea, everything, both genetically but also culturally, originates from Clovis. So everything you find here, whatever is found in South America, in Native Americans, should really originate from Clovis. Well, that's not the case, I can say. That was very clear from this study, and it was a major blow to the Clovis first idea. And today, there's been other studies as well in North America. And there's a very famous one actually earlier than us by a guy in South in Chile. And the whole, when I started into this area in 2007, 2008, you know, the vast majority, at least of American archaeologists, believed in Clovis first. Now it's the opposite. There's of course always somebody who will go to the grave believing in Clovis first, but the majority has changed their minds. What about the route they took? Well, as I told you about the interior ice-free corridor, right? Here we have Alaska, here we have Siberia, and the kind of classical view is that people were traveling these 1,500 kilometers through the interior ice-free corridor. Other people have suggested it was the coast. What is amazing, I think, about the whole ice-free corridor thing is that there's been done a lot of investments in finding out when did this corridor open so people could move. And it opens around 13,000 years ago. That's pretty clear. But that doesn't mean it's the same as people could survive that travel, right? What was the animal and plant life like in that corridor? If any of you guys have ever been to Greenland at the ice margins, it's a super unpleasant environment. I mean, it's not something I would walk 1,500 kilometers along. So we decided to try to find out, you know, what is the kind of succession, I mean, what is the development, biological development of the ice-free corridor? So my poor PhD student here, Mikkel, went to Alberta in the winter, which is representing the last area of the ice-free corridor to open. He found lakes that is believed to also have been lakes during that time, drilled through the water column into the sediments, pull out lake sediments. And those sediments, we dated them, and we also retrieved then the DNA from the sediments. And what is very clear is that although the corridor opens 30,000, it's first by around 2,600 years ago that you start seeing any biology in there. The first thing we see is a steppe vegetation, with, and we also find DNA of woolly mammoth and bison. After a few thousand years, you start seeing poplar trees coming in, and the mammoth is exchanged by elks. And then after some more thousand years, the open land forest is changed by boreal forest, and you see things like moose getting in there. But you can get a very detailed record with this environmental DNA of what's going on there. So I stand by the claim, I think it's very unlikely that the first peoples getting into the Americas came through the interior ice field corridor. And that really leaves, at the moment, it only really leaves the coastal route as a possibility. No one has tested that in the same way yet, but that's what it's pointing at the moment. What about, now we're talking about the first people, the very early people. Has there been other people before Europeans in the Americas? Well, there has been a long, long discussion of whether the Polynesians reached South America. So, as you probably know, many of you, in the Polynesians, you know, really developed this enormous, you know, seafare capabilities with their catamarans, right? And were basically traveling across the South Pacific, reaching New Zealand, reaching Hawaii, reaching the Easter Islands. The question is, did they reach South America? And some people have claimed, yes, there's the commonness of the sweet potato and the chicken and all kinds of things. And, well, the critics have said, yeah, well, we're not really convinced here. I'm not saying I have the answer for you. I'm not claiming that. But I have some results that are quite intriguing in regard to this debate. But it needs further work. Let me start this, make that clear from the beginning. We were asked by some of your Brazilian colleagues to look at skeletons known as Butucudo. I mean, I'm not a specialist in anthropology in Brazil by any means, but what I was told was, well, it's people with these earplugs and mouthplugs, but in fact, most likely, it's many different tribes that got that kind of name by the Portuguesians. But they were, to a large extent, at least, killed off in the end of the 1800s. But some of their cranial morphology seems very different, according to these anthropologists. Two of these individuals turned out genetically to be Polynesians. When we did C14 dating of it, one has to be very careful because there can be a marine reservoir effect, right? When they are, I mean, when they're eating marine food or very, you can say seafood, for example, or food from lakes. But even if you are most conservative, if you take your most conservative approach concerning the dating, it is not before the first Brazilians entering, but it's before, definitely before, the first established contact between Europe and Polynesia. It's also before any registered slave trade into South America from this area. We can also rule out, I would say genetically, that they are the Polynesians. There was also people going to Madagascar, and we can also rule that out. So the question is, could this be evidence of Polynesians entering or not? I would say we don't know, but it is certainly very intriguing. Either it's a sample fuck up, if you want, at the museum, over the many years, well, that happens. It's not only here, it's happened all over the world. We see that sometimes it's possible. We try to go back. I sent my postdoc down to the museum in Brazil, going through the records. We couldn't find any evidence of such of sample swap, but it's a possibility, right? But if it's not, but the way to test this, I think, is, of course, to test more Butucudo groups and see whether this result comes up. The reason why I'm still kind of hanging on a bit to the idea that this is not a sample mess up is we got another very intriguing result. And this was from the Eastern Islands. The Easter Islands are the that is occupied by Polynesians is the area closest to South America that is occupied by Polynesians, right? And You know, back in the day when you started doing DNA testing, people found out, oh yeah, these guys are Polynesians, they came from Polynesia, etc. But we actually took some of these samples of living Easter Islanders, and it's right that the majority of the genetic ancestry is Polynesian, but they are also Native American. There's actually traces of Native American in them. Well, that's not too surprising. There was Native American slaves brought to Easter Islands at some point. However, what is intriguing here is that you can actually date the event of this admixture between the Native Americans and the Polynesians based on the fragment length of the Native American signatures. And when you do that, it dates well before any European contact to the Easter Islands. So to me, that really suggests that there must have been a contact between Native Americans and East Islands. Again, it's a lot of smoke, but we still need to see a fire, right? And the fire would be, of course, to find an ancient individual, pre-Columbian, as in the East Island, being Native American, and in the here in South America, being Polynesian, right? That would be the end of the discussion. But it is quite interesting. It is interesting. Okay, let me see how I'm doing on time here, because I've been talking and talking, and I'm not sure I can manage all of this. Let me just see. Oh my God. Okay, we'll try to move quickly here. Sorry. Okay. Well, I wanted to present some data for you, not from the Americas, but from Europe, because it tells you something about how the field are moving and what could be done here in the Americas if one can get access to human remains and do the sequencing. So all these studies I've talked about, you know, are single genomes or very few genomes. But what about doing real population genomic studies of the past? And we decided to do that at some point a couple of years ago. And we decided to look at the Bronze Age of Eurasia. It's the period between 5,000 and 2,000 years ago, because there's a lot of human remains and there's a lot of discussion going on, because the Bronze Age is a period of massive cultural changes in Europe and Central Asia, but no one knows whether this was due to diffusion, I mean trading of goods, for example, diffusion of ideas, or whether it was actually the movements of peoples. So we decided, we collected samples. This is Denmark here you are Sweden, and this is Europe, Italy down here, right? And this is into Central Asia. So we collected Bronze Age samples across Europe and into Central Asia, and we managed to sequence more than 100 ancient human genomes. And this is feasible now. In fact, we have a study soon where there's many more than that. So it's this is what it can take us. And this told us some very interesting things in terms of this data. So it's very clear from the data that the Bronze Age has been a period of major human migrations in Europe and Asia. And in fact, here you can see you have Europe, Italy down here, right? Asia over here. So at 5,000 years ago, there's a group of people called Yamnaya that is spreading into northwestern Europe, where they're mixing with the early farmers that are living there. At the same time, the Yamnaya is also moving east across the Ural to Central Asia. And this early spread here, northwest and east, has been predicted by many linguists as this must have happened with the early spread of what is known as the Indo-European languages. It's also Portuguese, it's Danish, talked by most people around the world, many peoples around the world. And linguistics had predicted this to happen, but there was no way to show it. And suddenly, right, with genetics, you could actually show that happened. And here, these Yamnaya people replaced these Native American ancestors that you saw from Lake Baikal. They were living here, but these guys came in replacing them. Then in the end of the Bronze Age, some 3,500 to 2,500 years ago, there's another big migration, this time out of Northern Europe, across the Ural Mountains, into that area that was occupied by the Yamnaya people. And these guys, Sintasta they're called, they are warriors, they have wagons, horses, and they are basically taking up this area inside Central Asia. So what we can see until just around 1,000, maybe 1,500 years ago, Central Asia, around Mongolia, Western China, those areas, were occupied by people of European descent. Until just 1,000 years ago. So this whole, it's a very extremely dynamic area. I mean, when we get further in the Iron Age, what we can see, I have it in here, and the horses become common, there's one replacement after the each other every, you know, 100-200 years, right? A new warlord is coming in, you know? And this is the time where then East Asians expand into this area, and you can say mixing up. They're basically mixing up with these European populations living in there. And what is very interesting is if you take a Central Asian person from Kazakhstan and places like this today, they genetically, they're almost 100% East Asian, but there's a tiny trace, a tiny, tiny genetic trace of something European. And, you know, normally people thought, well, it was the Russians, you know, the Russian soldiers coming, mating with the local women or whatever. But no, it's actually going back down there from, you know, the time of the Bronze Age. And you can use this to kind of reshape how was the genetic diversity formed in Europe. And think about it, we could do the same thing here in the Americas. So all the gray here is present-day genetic diversity in Europe, right? And as you can see here, here we have samples of late hunter-gatherers in Europe. They are falling outside the genetic diversity of present-day Europeans. Here we have the early farmers also falling outside the genetic diversity of present-day Europeans. But during the Bronze Age, this is where the world that we know of today, genetically in Europe, was shaped, right? And the same thing for Asia. Here we have this ancestor of Native Americans from Lake Baikal falling outside. Then we have the Yamnaya migration into Central Asia. It starts forming genetic diversity. And with the Sintasta, it even formed more. So in other words, the genetic differences that we see among Europeans today, different East Europeans, Southern Europeans, Western Europeans, are extremely recent. Extremely recent. Everything happened within the last 10,000 years. I mean, before that, you know, we were all very similar in Europe. But when you start also having that amount of data, you can also start looking at phenotypic traits and how have the frequency of these phenotypic traits changed through time. So for example, lactose tolerance, the ability to break down milk sugar, is a very rare phenomenon globally as adults. Of course, we can all do it. We can all drink milk when we are children, but when we grow up, most people around the world actually become sick when they're doing it. They can't break down the milk sugar. Except one of those exceptions is Northern Europe, where some 70-80% of the population can actually, as adult, drink milk. And most people thought, well, this happened with agriculture. When agriculture came into Europe around, you know, starting around 10,000 years ago, you know, this is when there was selection for this ability. No, what we can see from these studies here is that this is something that has only become common within the last 3,000 years, 2,000 or 3,000 years, you know, very, very recently. And most likely it came from the Yamnaya. The Yamnaya has a slightly higher tolerance frequency, and they had huge herds of animals that they drew up with them and that they were milking. So most likely this ability that we as North Europeans are very proud of actually came extremely late with a migration by the Yamnaya, most likely. Also phenotypically, they had a huge impact on us. I mean, most peoples in Europe of modern humans before the Yamnaya migration probably look quite similar to this guy here. Very dark skin, blue or gray eyes, quite small in stature. Then the Yamnaya has the very light skin that is very common today among Northern Europeans, and they were very tall people. And it's probably that it seems to be the Yamnaya that largely brought in that phenotype. Very late, again, very late in European history. Then we were very puzzled about, you can say, why do you see these population replacements taking place, especially in Central Asia? How can it be that the Yamnaya locally seem to erase or remove or whatever the Malta? How can it be the Santasta takes over from the Yamnaya? And we thought maybe it's climate changes. We looked at climate change, we couldn't see anything. And suddenly one archaeologist said, what about diseases? And the only disease we have heard about in the past having major implication is plague, right? Is pestis. But this is way too early for pestis. I mean, pestis epidemics known are you know, 3,000 years later in history. But still, we decided to look for it in these samples. And it banged out. You know, about 10% of the population during the Bronze Age was infected by pestis bacteria. And what is amazing is these strains of pestis are all basal to present-day pestis strains. So it's extinct strains of pestis. But there's a lot known about pestis because people are still dying from pestis today. Actually, in America, there's people being, you know, from rodents, getting it from rodents, and also in China, I think. But these, so therefore you know a lot about what mutations are giving what capabilities. And what we can see over time is that it's also different what most people thought. Most people thought that the version of the pestis bacteria that survives in the flea gut and is transmitted through the fleas are the oldest version. It's not. The oldest version is the one that is directly transmitted from human to human by saliva or blood. And then in the end of the Bronze Age, we start seeing them getting, the bacteria getting that mutation that allows it to survive in the flea gut. And that creates, you know, these blisters and all that you see from the movies of pestis, right, from Ben-Hur and all that stuff, is created during that time. So it's an amazing thing. Now, of course, we are screening all our samples for ancient diseases. And I tell you, It's been very nasty living in the past. I mean, it's been really unpleasant. I mean, a lot of these people are infected by really bad things. Leprosy, there's a lot of frequency of hepatitis B and, you know, tetanus and, yeah. But it's of course super exciting in the sense that now we can really follow the evolution and spread of these diseases through time. Okay, now, sorry, I got carried away a couple of times here. But let's go to the megafauna extinction, because this is also something that we have worked with. We're not doing so much work in that area anymore, but I was very kind of, it was very exciting for me to do this. It's a big debate that has been going on for years, right? I mean, if you go back to South America, North America, Asia, Europe, and you just go back some 10,000-12,000 years, you would see an environment that was very different from today. And one of the things that makes it different was, at this time, there was a large diversity of big-bodied mammals, of large mammals. We call them megafauna, right? There you had the ground sloth, right? One of them, there was horses up to north, mammoth, woolly rhino. There was even lions running around it, and hyenas running around in the snow in northern Asia. It was a very exciting time. For unknown reasons, the majority of this megafauna goes extinct, presumably close to the end of the last ice age, around 10,000-11,000 years ago. And of course, it's a mass extinction. I mean, it's like two-thirds, has been estimated, two-thirds of animal genera of the megafauna is vanishing. And what is causing this extinction? Of course, has been puzzling for scientists for many, many years. And there's really two, you can say, main hypotheses. One is it was humans. Humans spread into the northern areas, into the Americas, like Clovis with the big spear points, killing off one after the other of this megafauna. And according to this idea of human overkill, it happened very quickly, 1,000 years after first contact, they're gone. Because they never seen humans before, they were just standing like, oh, The critics of this theory, of course, says, how can you believe that a few humans with a quite simple technology could take out all this megafauna? They said, no, it must be due to climatic changes. We know that the climate became warmer and more humid in the end of the last ice age, and according to that model, that resulted, you can say, in change of vegetation and collapse of the ecosystem. And this, of course, is much more than just the discussion of what happened to the megafauna. Because this tells us potentially to resolve this issue, potentially tells us what can we expect from contemporary, concurrent climate changes, right? I mean, if it was climate change that took out these animals, I would say we will be facing an extremely uncertain period, right? In terms of what will the impact be. The impact of that climate change, if it was climate change, was massive. And what we can expect from the current thing now is huge, huge changes, if that model is right. On the other hand, if it's correct, it was humans, well, the next time a Native American are sitting on television or another indigenous population saying, you know, oh, we Mother Nature, we live in harmony with Mother Nature, it's like, the fuck, you killed off all the megafauna. So, in other words, I mean, it has actually some implications that are larger than just the study of the megafauna. Well, we did what I believe is still actually the largest genetic study ever undertaken to address this question. So we collected samples across Europe and North America and Asia, and we dated them hundreds for each species, and dated them and obtained DNA from them in order to reconstruct how these populations have changed through time. We also obtained what is known as climate niche data. And what you do there is that you know, of course, when you find a woolly rhino here in Siberia and you know the age of it, then you know, well, it was living here, right, at that time. And then we can use that information to actually say, well, how would this distribution of these animals be if it was only climate that determined the distribution? Finally, what we also did was we also looked into the archaeological record, really going into detail of saying, when do you find evidence of hunting? When do you find evidence of human presence in different areas, etc.? And to make a very long story short, what we see is a very clear correlation between climate niche and changes in population size. In other words, climate change is a major driver of these populations when they go up and down. And in many cases, we find no evidence in our data set for human interference. So for example, muskox, here we have it, is today found only naturally in northern Canada and Greenland. But back then, it was distributed also in Asia and Europe, but it went extinct there. But when it went extinct there, there was no humans in that area. They were living up very far north, and there's absolutely no evidence around the time of extinction that there's human overlap with them. I'm not saying that humans didn't play a role. I think they did in certain instances, but I'm saying what I believe is that the major driver is related to climate. This is what it shows here. So what about the climate could cause this extinction? And to address this question, we use this environmental DNA, DNA from sediments. So we caught permafrost samples. This is Alaska, and you have here, this is Siberia, this is Europe. So we collected more than 200 permafrost samples across the northern hemisphere, dated them, obtained DNA from them to reconstruct how has the vegetation changed. We also sampled present day population of plants for comparison across this region here. What we also did was we got access to some of these megafauna animals that sometimes are found in Siberia and Alaska, where they're frozen, right? Where they're basically frozen. They find a frozen horse or frozen mammoth with, I mean, there's skin on it and hair on it, and it has its stomach content. And we got access to the stomach content, and then we also sequenced the stomach content of these animals to find out what was it. So what do we see here? Well, what we see is when we go back, you know, 50,000 years, the vegetation in all this northern hemisphere was very different from today. The vegetation is much, much more rich. There's many more species. And the dominant group of plants is actually not grasses, as many people have said. It's forbs, which are very nutrient-rich. Then we get to the what is known as the last glacial maximum. This is the coldest and driest stage of the last ice age, around 20,000 years ago. And we see a massive drop in the diversity, but it's still a subset of the original diversity here, still dominated by these forbs. Then it becomes warm again. And of course, then what I thought, at least, I would thought, well, when it becomes warm again, the vegetation must change back to what we had before. No, this is not what happens. It completely changes, and completely changes into the vegetation we know from that area, those areas today. So the first lesson here, which I think is a very important lesson, is even if we get the climate under control, right, the global warming under control, and we reverse the process, it doesn't mean we are returning to what we knew before. And this is quite important, right? So it also means that it's extremely unpredictable what is coming out of this whole global warming. But this new composition of plants that we see here is very different. It's rich in grasses and shrubs and has very little of these nutrient-rich forms. If you then look at the stomach content of these animals, the dominant food source of these animals seems to be these forms that are disappearing. So what I think is going on here, it can be all kind of complex interactions, but a very simple explanation is climate is mainly driven, the vegetation changes, and the vegetation changes is really what takes off most of these animals. Then I'll just end very quickly, very quickly by saying how far back in time can we go with this? Well, we still have the record for the oldest ancient genome sequence to date. This is from a 700,000 year old horse up from Alaska. It's not that cold, -2 degrees in the permafrost up here. It's actually in the Yukon, northern Canada, close to Alaska. And this horse is kind of, you can also reconstruct that genome, how the population size have changed. And it also fits actually very well with climatic changes. We can also look at selection. I mean, what traits were under selection of horses? We also sequenced a number of other ancient horses. And for example, you know, back then, 700,000 years ago, it was mainly the horse ability to smell and its immune system that was under selection. I mean, the whole muscles, all the muscles, you know, that we find in horses today, these very powerful animals, that selection happens much later. I mean, we can see from some of the other ones here. But we could also use it to address a long-standing issue in conservation biology. Namely, is there any true wild horses left in the world? Because all the wild horses you see around, including the Americas, of course, but Australia and other places, all those horses are domestic horses that got wild again, right, after being domesticated. There's only one candidate for a true wild horse, and that's the Przewalski horse down in Mongolia. The problem is with the Przewalski horse is, of course, that it was on the brink of extinction in the 40s. There was like 30 individuals left. For thousands of years, it has been surrounded by domestic horses. And the question was, is there any full-blooded Przewalski horses left? And there was no way to address this question because there was no other wild horses than the Przewalski horse, right? So how to address it? But I can guarantee you that the 700,000-year-old horse was wild. And it's very clear that there is in fact some individuals of the Przewalski that seems to have no admixture with domestic horses. And this is of course what you want to emphasize on in your efforts of preserving that species. There's a couple of papers, recent review papers we've done on these topics. And then I will just say that of course this work was not done by me. It was done by my poor postdocs and PhD students and others from the Center for Geogenetics that has been worked very hard in the lab and at the computer to generate all this data. Thank you very much for your attention.
Questions can ask also in Portuguese, we can translate. First, I just have a general question because we are, it's a political question too, because we are very much interested in ancient DNA analysis. For the last 5 years, we are fighting this university to get the DNA facility analysis in your taxonomic collections building that we have money from FINEP, to build, but we couldn't start building. So my question is, do you think we don't have any facility like this in South America, I would say, for ancient DNA genomics? What do you think we'll need for that? Do you think we have people, but we don't have that much money? How should we start?
I would say you have, of course, here, you have all the samples in the world, right? That would be interesting to look at. Compared to where I'm from, right, we don't have any samples of interest. So I have to go around the world trying to get access. But you guys have it all. You have it all. So it would, it would be, as I see it, it would be a very natural thing to do, to generate such a lab. And it's, of course, the challenge is really two things. It's the technical part of it. It's quite technical demanding, but it's by no means impossible. Everybody can learn it. It's not that difficult. It's difficult, but not that difficult. Then, of course, it's the funding, because it's quite expensive to run. I'm talking about the consumables of running it, right? So you need to somehow make a strategy for that. But otherwise, what I would do, and you're very welcome at my labs in Copenhagen and Cambridge, is of course to exchange students and postdocs. And so you could learn, learn the technique, right? Learn to do it properly and then come back here and establish yourself. It's an endless, one thing is humans that I've been focusing on here, but if you talk about megafauna, if you talk about environmental changes, right? There's endless projects, to be done. I would be very supportive of that.
Oh, I have two questions. Yeah. The first one is relatively simple. It's about the problem of the water goodness. It was raised the possibility that the two specimens looks much closer to the body nations are actually mistaken. It seems to me that it's a relatively easy to solve. You make some fabled isotopes with key. Somebody do that?
Yeah. Yes. What we actually looked at, we tried to do strontium. But the problem is with the strontium is that what it demands is that there's actually differences in the surrounding environment, right? Whether it's from South America or where it's from, and you didn't have that resolution in the environment. So we did try it to see if we could get to resolve it that way, but we could not. So unfortunately, we could have been lucky, but we were not. I think really that, I agree, and I'm still open that it's a sample swap done sometimes over those whatever hundred years or whatever the samples have been. But that said, of course, I think that you always can say that when you find the result that people don't expect to get, right? This is always like, oh yeah, it's a sample swap, and this might be true. And of course, you should investigate that, and we try to do that. I even sent the person to the museum, going through the files, right, to try to find out. What we need is more samples. We need more Burukuru samples, but it's not as simple, I think, as just saying whatever Burukuru, then it has to be a Polynesian, and then we resolve it, right? Because the Burukuru, as far as I understand, you know, has been, that name has been used for many different tribes. So it could be that some, what we call Burukuru, is in fact Native Americans, and some that is called Burukuru is something else, right? But we would need more, I mean, the way to resolve this would be to investigate more samples. And of course, one of the main criticisms for saying it's a Polynesian is that it's found in Brazil rather than Chile. That was one of the main criticisms. But from my standpoint, I understand that criticism, but from my standpoint, I mean, what we see, what people were capable of in the past, when we look at, I didn't go through this, but the peopling of Australia, for example, I mean, these guys were remarkable. I mean, and it's just because we always think about, oh, myself crossing the Andes Mountain or crossing south of South America in a small boat, oh my God, you know, but these guys, I mean, did amazing things and were traveling amazingly distances. So I don't think you can use that kind of argumentation, really. I mean, but of course, what you need is more samples.
Just want to make a comment regarding the Burukuru samples. That was a PhD student of mine who discovered the by sequencing the mitochondrial DNA. And see, we don't have an old DNA lab, so she went to the botanics department, which was the only labs in the Institute of Biological Science that had never had any human or mammalian DNA, and then we sent those to ASCII to confirm, and they were confirmed. So there was absolutely no chance of contamination, and there was confirmation. So if there was any switch, and again we cannot rule that out, it was in the National Museum, you know, at the source. Yeah.
But I mean, there's no evidence for it, let's put it that way, right? And it's even written on the skull, you know, with 1800 century writing Burukuru across the skull.
Yeah, it was written
So.
I have a second question, but regarding the extinction. You're obviously familiar with the Barnowski paper about the extinctions in the continent. And so the timing of extinctions, the megafauna extinctions in the different countries is different. Europe and Africa have different timing, and the impact in terms of percentage of the fauna also is larger in North and South America and in Australia. Australia has the oldest of the extinctions, and North and South America are the latest. But the conditions in all these areas are different. I don't know if you are familiar or aware about the work mainly by Argentinian people about the hypothesis of the broken zigzag. Have you heard about it? The idea is the following. Along the Pleistocene, you have a lot of times in which the alternated between interglacials and glacial peaks. And this change in South America, the distribution of open and closed arcs, open and closed arcs. Obviously, megafauna is more larger populations when the area is open than when closed. But along the Pleistocene, all these species passed through these moments of retraction of number of populations. The difference of the timing in the population, dated about 1100 thousand years, is that the man entered it. Probably the man entered a little bit before, as the Monteverde shows. But with the retraction of the late of the era of the maximum glacial, the man was here. So a little extraction of a population of megafauna will drive the entire population to extinction, even if this will not happen when the population was larger. At that time, sure. It's critical.
Sure. I mean, I'm not claiming that all megafauna across the various continents were caused by climate change. We've only investigated you can say the Northern Hemisphere, right? To me, Northern Hemisphere evidence is very clear. I mean, that it's climate driven. That doesn't mean that it's the same in South America or in Australia. And in order to really, I think, understand what's going on there, you need to do similar kind of research, right? And I mean, here you would have that possibility. You would have it here in South America. You have all the specimens. You have it all. It's just a matter of doing it, really. I mean, and you can get that answer. And it would be an extremely important, as I talked about, you know, during my talk, to understand what is driving this, right? Because it really tells us something about what we can expect in the future. So, I mean, here you have it all. I would say in Australia, that's also doable, but it's more challenging because, you know, the preservation is poorer, it's older, and so forth. But the logical place to do that exercise is here. I mean, so, yeah.
Well, which are your forecasts for the industry today concerning the scope of climate change that are occurring nowadays?
I guess if you could make a proper prediction about that, you will win the Nobel Prize. But I mean, really, I think that the main problem that we are facing as humans is, you know, the combination of that climate change coupled with the tremendous increase in population size, right? I mean, that's the problem. I mean, I don't think there would be, I personally wouldn't be too worried if we had been, you know, one-third the population size of Earth that we are today. I mean, because then I'm sure there will be areas around, you know, that are suitable for proper living. The question is we know that from all other mammals that, you know, there's a carrying capacity, right? It's how it is, right? There's a carrying capacity, and when you reach that, it says boom. And then you are, I mean, the population basically crashes, right? And this is, of course, what you can be tremendously worried about in regard to the development we see, because if less and less space actually becomes, you can say, inhabitable, you know, and the population size increases, unless we leave Earth and take occupation outside Earth, I mean, well, we will face that. Of course, we can technologically, we can change, and this is different from other animals, of course, we have the potential to change that carrying capacity. But, of course, there's a limit. I mean, if anything else, there's a limit in terms of space, right? It's just how it is. I mean, so I'm actually quite worried. Well, I'm not for an extinction of the human species, but for, you could say, the consequences of these poor individuals, these poor souls living at the time when this is happening. Yes.
So you must think that we must control the growth of the population.
I think, to be honest, I mean, I'm now becoming political. That was not. I really think that you know, we have all these forums about, you know, how to deal with climate change, how to deal with war or avoiding of war, and so forth. I mean, if it was me who had anything to say in this, I would have the main focus would be the growth, population growth that we see here on Earth, because that's really the key issue. I mean, if we weren't facing that issue, you know, we could face many of these other climatic changes and all that without a big worry, right? But the worry is really that growth, as I see it. But, yeah.
Good afternoon. My name is Lucas. Yeah. I'm studying history, and it seems that in your research, your work has helped a lot along with the Indo-European theory about languages. To what extent it also works the other way around?
Language is helping.
Yes. What extent language, the linguistic research, help your research?
It does. I mean, so we are currently working in on a study, for example, on the spread of the Indo-European languages to South Asia. I mean, to India and Pakistan and those places, and where we are trying to combine, you know, cultural information, linguistic information, and genetic information, and it's a you know, everybody helps everybody. That's how I look at it, you know. So every study we are doing, we are always trying to involve specialists within those particular areas, right? I mean, I'm not a specialist in, not even the bloody Americas. I mean, I'm not an archaeologist, I'm not an anthropologist, right? I'm a geneticist. So you need, you know, in order to make any reasonable interpretation of what you find, and also what are the consequences of what you find, you need to collaborate with peoples within different areas. So we, so, and as I see it, I mean, each of these groups, each of these fields are crucial to each other. And one couldn't, I mean, we could, if there was only genetics, if there was nothing else, we couldn't survive. I mean, I could close my computer and go back home. Because, well, I would see something, but what does it mean, what I see, right? So, so we need each other, and I enjoy a lot. This is one of the things I really enjoy about this work, is actually the multidisciplinary nature of the work. I mean, we have meetings where we are sitting, you know, archaeologists, linguistics, geneticists, chemists, you know, informatics people, mathematicians, statisticians, etc., together, trying to figure out what's going on here, right? And you become so much wiser, each, I'm sure I do at least, and I'm sure many others also, it's the case, right? We become so much wiser by this interaction than if you had been sitting alone. So we all need each other, and we're using, of course, linguistics to pinpoint us in the right direction, where there's something interesting going on, also, and to also say, well, does everything, we have cases also where the genetics doesn't fit the linguistics, right? So where you can say it's two separate processes, for example. So linguistics, of course, also can be transmitted without a lot of people, right? I mean, if you have like a very dominant group, small but extremely dominant group, right? They can influence a whole population, right? I mean, think about the Brits in India, for example, right? Very few, massive impact, right? So, and this happened in the past, of course, as well, so.
I can make example between Brazil and Peru, for instance. When in Peru they speak Spanish, here we speak Portuguese. Most of the genomes in Peru are Native Americans. In Brazil, they are European. So it's a difference because the process was different. The effective number of Native American populations in Peru in the Andes was much bigger. The cities there were bigger than Europe. So that's the difference. We can find this difference. We have good explanations for that.
So it's very exciting times, I think, to have this interdisciplinary collaboration, and it's, you know, it's really humanities meeting natural sciences, and it's wonderful. I mean, I just enjoy it a lot.
I'm Lizia, I'm an economist here from the Faculdade de Ciências Econômicas. There is a book making a very strong impact in my area, which is Economic Growth, okay? This book is from Nicholas Waite, and he highlights the difference among people that were more recently shaped in our human genome. I like, and he exactly stressed that this change were more recent, like the lactose one that you mentioned. Should I pay attention to this, to his work?
Yeah, I think so. It makes sense, huh? Yeah.
I don't think you should pay attention to it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Nicholas Waite is a journalist from the New York Times, and he's not a scientist. And he decided to work work on the distribution of diversity, and he came out with some very racialist bills, which are completely outdated. So most of the, you know, actually the scientists were cited in Nicholas Wade's book, wrote a manifest in the United States that they refused to have their name associated with his book. So I think that, you know, that's not a book that you should use as a source.
Sorry.
Just one more question. Since I can't, I have to forget. I don't think it's exactly your curiosity, but how do you, how it is your view about the levels of equality, inequality within the hunter-gatherer people?
What do you mean by equality?
Distribution of resource among,
within the communities.
Depends on the environment.
I mean, between themselves.
Yeah,
that's what you're talking about,
yeah.
Right? Between the
and
individuals
and levels of conflict within themselves, not among between groups.
No, but within groups, right? The distribution. I know not much about this. What I do know is that it's not. I know at least it's not identical across different hunter-gatherer groups. Because you have people, for example, like the Ik in Africa, which at least, I mean, according to what you can read, you know, are just stealing from each other. They see they're standing watching, looking for a fire in the forest, and then the neighbor is sitting, eating something, and then they run out, shut up the neighbor and take the stuff. I don't know, but so it's, I don't know whether this is true. This is what you can read, but so I don't know whether it's the same. You can say whether the systems are identical across different hunter-gatherer groups. I just don't know, because this is more like a behavioral thing, right? Rather than genetics. I mean, yeah, it's cultural. Yeah, exactly. But I don't know. And okay. I don't dare recommend you anything. Do after.
Uma última pergunta? Não? Bem, gostaria de agradecer. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much for your attention. Thanks.